Welcome to ATCM, the Emergency Medicine Channel. Today we are discussing about chronic obstructive pulmonary disease or COPD. There are two different types of COPD, chronic bronchitis and chronic emphysema. Both are chronic airway disease. These two diseases together called as COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary or airway disease. The main problem in this disease is chronic inflammation of alveoli and chronic inflammation of bronchiole, either bronchiole or alveoli or together. If you are the predominant involvement is bronchiole, then you call it as chronic bronchitis. If the alveoli is predominantly involved, we call it as chronic emphysema. So these are the two major diseases coming under COPD. So it's a chronic airway disease which is progressive, irreversible, and it predominantly involves smaller airways in the lung. The major risk factor for COPD in our country is chronic cigarette smoking. Okay, the chronic cigarette smoking is one of the major risk factor which can produce inflammation and destruction of the alveoli and bronchiole that leads to COPD. That's why many patients who are chronic smokers, they develop chronic breathing difficulty. That is because of COPD development in these type of patients. Other risk factors are chronic air pollution, exposure to chronic smoke and dust, chronic lung infection like adenovirus infection, HIV infection, chronic occupational exposure to coal mine exposure or different type of fumes, lower socioeconomic status with chronic inflammation or infections of lung also can produce COPD. One of the genetical diseases, that is alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency, can also produce chronic emphysema. So these are the risk factors, but the major risk factor is always cigarette smoking. Now we'll see the pathological changes in the alveoli and bronchus. The COPD mainly affects smaller airways. Larger airway involvement may be there, but it is predominantly seen in asthma, not in COPD. Here the smaller airways are largely involved. There will be hypertrophy of mucus producing glands. Global cell hyperplasia can occur. There will be a reduction in the ciliary cells and sluggish movements can be seen in the lungs. Mucosal edema can be there. Hypertrophy of smooth muscles of bronchus. Reduced caliber of air spaces. These are the changes occurring in the COPD. These changes predominantly occurs in the smaller airways of lung. Remember, larger airways are involved in asthma, but predominantly smaller airways are involved in COPD. Now we have already discussed that there are two different types of COPD. One is chronic bronchitis, other one is emphysema. Chronic bronchitis, by definition, it is cough. It's a predominantly disease with cough. Cough with expectoration most of the days for at least 3 months of a year for more than 2 years. Then only you can diagnose it as chronic bronchitis. Somebody getting a acute breathlessness, acute cough, you call it as acute bronchitis. But somebody is having chronic cough more than 2 years, minimum 3 months involvement should be there. Then only we can clinically diagnose it as chronic bronchitis. So the predominant feature in chronic bronchitis is cough. Predominant cough with progressive breathlessness. That is a main feature in the chronic bronchitis. Chronic bronchitis changes in the lung, that is very, very prominent. There will be increased mucosal glands in the alveoli. Slowly the alveolar space or the air space will be coming down. The reduced air space is the major problem in the chronic bronchitis, and inflammation, thick secretions can occur. We'll see the clinical features of chronic bronchitis. Mostly patient will come with severe cough. So progressive cough for many years, history of smoking is there. That is a major feature of chronic bronchitis. The symptoms are chronic productive cough for many years. At least 2 years should be there for a diagnosis. Cough increases during winter season. Sputum is normally mucoid and scanty. During infective exacerbation, sputum will be purulent. Remember, the exacerbation is always infective. Breathlessness usually a late feature in the chronic bronchitis. Signs, what are the signs we'll see? Predominantly it is crepitation. When you auscultate the chest of the chronic bronchitis patient, you get predominantly crepitation because of the increased production of sputum. But some patients can have bilateral wheeze also. So the predominant feature is always crepitations. Whereas if you see the clinical criteria for emphysematosis, it's an abnormal and permanent enlargement of the distal air spaces, distal to terminal bronchiole, and accompanied by destruction of the walls. So it is a permanent dilatation and destruction of the terminal bronchiole. So emphysema is permanent dilatation and destruction of the terminal bronchiole. Now we'll see the clinical features of emphysema. So emphysema patients will have progressive breathlessness than cough, but they can also have some cough. On examination, you can see barrel-shaped chest. That normally the chest is AP diameter is smaller than transverse diameter. Here it is like a barrel. And tracheal descent occurring during inspiration. When you take a deep inspiration, you can see trachea moves down because of the breathing difficulty. Hoover sign, that is another sign. It's an inward motion of the lower lateral rib cage with inspiration. That is a sign of severe emphysematous disease. You can see cyanosis or pursed lip breathing. Pursed lip breathing is like breathing like this. That is because patient is trying to block the air which is leaving out very fast, trying to block it. Hyperresonant knot on the lung percussion is another sign. Cardiac dullness is obliterated. Liver dullness shifted down. Vesicular breath sounds only you can get on auscultation, but it is reduced. And wheeze with crepitation can be there. Patient with chronic emphysema is classically referred as pink puffers, that is secondary to polycythemia. Whenever you have hypoxemia, the erythropoietin level will be increased by the kidneys and you can have polycythemia. And pursed lip breathing, we have explained, that is a very common finding in this type of patients. If you take an x-ray and see in emphysematous patient, you can see hypertranslucent x-rays. That means more black in color. Tubular heart, that is narrow heart, is a classical finding. Pushed down diaphragm, diaphragm is pushed down. And widely placed horizontal ribs, you can see. Pulmonary arteries can be very prominent. These are the x-ray finding. Whatever it may be, when you are taking an x-ray, you can see more black lungs is a classical feature of emphysema. Now, once you have a COPD patient, the best investigation of choice is always you go for a pulmonary function test in any patient who is having breathlessness, but it is not possible in acute conditions. Once the patient is stabilized, you have to go for a pulmonary function test where FEV1 is reduced. And it is after, like if you see the FEV1, it is reduced to less than 80%. And after giving a nebulization of salbutamol, the reversibility is not more than 15%. It is less than 15% is the diagnostic feature of COPD. So the reversibility of the airway obstruction is not seen. It is less than 15%. That can be picked up by FEV1 in a pulmonary function test. That is a main feature differentiation between asthma and COPD. Here, reversibility is less than 15%, asthma it is more than 15%. That means asthma is reversible, COPD is irreversible. Now, if you see the difference between two types of COPD, that is emphysema and bronchitis. If you see in emphysema, you can see breathlessness is severe, cough is mild. Whereas cough is severe in bronchitis, sputum production is more in bronchitis, cyanosis is early in bronchitis, pulmonary hypertension is early in bronchitis, right ventricular failure is early in bronchitis, peripheral edema because of right heart failure is more in bronchitis, respiratory failure is early in bronchitis, chest x-ray shows significant changes like black lungs are more of a feature of bronchitis. Pulmonary function test also more in favor of a COPD seen in bronchitis. If you see the difference between asthma and COPD, both are airway diseases. Asthma is predominantly larger airway disease. COPD is a smaller airway disease. Family history is more frequently seen in asthmatic patients. Smoking history is seen in COPD patients. Childhood history is more seen in asthmatic patients. Atopy or allergy is more common in asthmatic patients. Reversibility is mainly seen in asthma. Progression is continuous in COPD. Exacerbation is more infective in COPD, more inflammatory in asthma. Steroids are very useful in asthma, but can be useful in COPD. Antibiotics are more useful in COPD patients. And if you do a PFT, reversibility less than 15% is the classical feature of COPD. Now, whenever a patient with COPD who is having acute infective exacerbation, when the patient comes to emergency room, always we have to take care of the airway, breathing, circulation. Remember, oxygenation in COPD is not like any other respiratory condition. It is, you have to limit the oxygen treatment in a patient who is having COPD. Because if you give more oxygen and if you remove the hypoxic respiratory drive in COPD, most of these patients may go to respiratory arrest. So you have to, initially you have to give good oxygenation, control the oxygenation afterwards, and try to keep the saturation just above 85%. No need to keep it above 95 or 96%. Just above 85%, you should reduce the oxygen to 2 to 3 liters. That is enough in COPD patients. Once you start oxygen, so you take the patient inside emergency room, take care his airway, breathing, circulation. Then you put the patient in propped up position. You start oxygen. Try to maintain the oxygen saturation above 85%, just above 85%. Then you have to give nebulization. Normally, we give salbutamol with ipratropium bromide nebulization. Salbutamol mainly acting on the larger airway, ipratropium bromide acting in the smaller airways. But in COPD and asthma, we give a combination of salbutamol with ipratropium. Ipratropium is more useful than salbutamol in COPD. So, at least three consecutive doses in 20 minutes apart you have to give. So, first dose can be given now. After 20 minutes, if the patient is not recovering, another dose, one more dose can be given. So, salbutamol with ipratropium combination is very useful in acute exacerbation. Another newer drug is rivaroxaban. That is one newer drug which can be used as a nebulized drug in acute exacerbation. Other treatment options in COPDs, you can give magnesium sulfate 3 gram IV infusion, which can prevent further episodes of COPD exacerbation. Antibiotics should be given in all patients who is having exacerbation. Normally, in a community acquired infection, you can give quinolones like levofloxacin 500 milligram to 750 milligram IV OD can be given. If the patient is having hospital acquired infection in a COPD, you have to go for a higher drug like ceftriaxone sulbactam or piperacillin tazobactam. That should be started. Azithromycin also can be used in patients who is having chronic lung inflammation. It can be given 250 milligram alternate days for at least 6 months. There is a chronic antibiotic therapy. Here we are using azithromycin's anti-inflammatory properties. Steroids can be used, but it is not very helpful like in asthma. It can be given steroid. Normally we give hydrocortisone 100 milligram IV once per day, at least for 5-7 days. Aminophylline, once it was used very commonly in COPD patient. Nowadays we are not using because of its very small therapeutic index. Some patients can go to dangerous arrhythmias. So aminophylline is not a drug of choice now, but still many doctors prefer to give aminophylline. 500 milligram can be given in 500 ml of dextrose, should be given over 24 hours. So slow infusion is very good in aminophylline infusion. Now, once the patient is once the patient is stabilized with your oxygen and nebulization, patient can be shifted to ward. If the patient is not improving with the nebulization, you have to go for non-invasive ventilation or BiPAP ventilation. BiPAP ventilation, indications for BiPAP ventilations are respiratory rate more than 25 or mild to moderate respiratory acidosis less than 7.5 pH or hypercarbia, PaCO2 more than 45. These are the indications to start NIV. But remember, some patients can go to NIV failure. We try to avoid mechanical ventilation in a patient with COPD because they will become permanently ventilator dependent. It is very difficult to wean off them from ventilator. So try to restrict these patients in NIV only, and you have to try to avoid mechanical ventilation. And once the patient is stabilized, he has to be put on oral drugs or MDIs. normally metered dose inhalers, normal metered dose inhalers are either you can go for formoterol 400 milligram, 400 microgram BD with low dose steroid inhaler, that is fluticasone 100 microgram BD with a tiotropium bromide 18 microgram BD. These are the commonly used drug in COPD follow-up. Formoterol 400 milligram BD, fluticasone 100 microgram BD, tiotropium 18 microgram BD. These are the commonly used drugs with low carbohydrate, high protein diet. When you are, when you have a COPD with acute exacerbation patient, if you give more carbohydrate diet, it may increase the carbon dioxide in his body. So try to avoid high carbohydrate diet. You have to go for high protein diet. That will build up, that will give energy, and it will build up the muscles which is requiring for the breathing. You have to correct the hypokalemia in this patient and hypomagnesemia in this patient. Both can increase the problem in a COPD patient. Many nebulizations can reduce potassium in your body. So correct potassium, correct magnesium. And finally, when the patient is getting discharged, we have to put the patient on long-term oxygen therapy. That means continuously give oxygen at least 16 hours per day, 2 to 4 liters. You should not give more oxygen and maintain higher saturation. Should give restricted oxygen, 2 to 4 liters per minute should be given at least 16 hours. This will reduce the pulmonary hypertension and improves the quality of life in the patient. Every patient with COPD should be given vaccination against H influenza and pneumococci. These are the strategies we have to follow in a patient with COPD. Thank you.